At 4:30 on the morning of April 12, 1861, a mortar shell crashed onto the parade ground of Fort Sumter. Almost at once, the Confederate battery surrounding the fort opened on all sides, and shot and shell went screaming over Sumter as if an army of devils were whooping it up. 33 hours later, the tiny federal garrison had surrendered. The bastion of the North had become a citadel of the rebellion. And, wrote Carl Sandburg, the war of words was over, and the naked test by steel weapons, so long foretold, was at last to begin. The attack on Sumter rallied both sides to their flags as no political oratory had been able to accomplish. In the South, the four holdout states promptly closed ranks with the secessionists. In the North, the newly elected president issued his first proclamation of the war, a call for 75,000 troops. Surveying the strength of his armed forces, Abraham Lincoln noted bitterly that officers of the Federal Army and Navy had resigned in great numbers, and many had taken up arms against the government. Among these was Robert E. Lee, a Virginian, who believed in union and opposed slavery, but whose loyalties rested with his native state. Lee was to be sorely missed, but during the first 2.5 years of the war, Lincoln was plagued by a succession of generals who were either weak, inept, or devoid of imagination. All of them, as Lincoln would have put it, had the slows. Union armies had failed repeatedly to deliver the crushing blow that would bring the war to an end, despite their superiority in numbers and materiel. In the titanic battles of Bull Run, the Peninsula, Antietam, Fredericksburg, and Chancellorsville, they'd been outmaneuvered, outfought, or sent reeling by their gray-clad opponents. Small wonder that the feeling in the Army of Northern Virginia was one of profound contempt for an enemy whom they'd beaten so constantly. In June 1863, Lee launched his invasion of the North. With little or no opposition, he swept through the Shenandoah Valley and up into Pennsylvania. The bands played Dixie and Bonnie Blue Flag, and the men cheered and sang as they crossed the Mason-Dixon line. On June 28th, President Lincoln, still searching for a fighting general, appointed George Gordon Meade to take over as head of the Army of the Potomac, its fourth commander in 10 months. A solid frontline officer, Meade had seen action in virtually every battle fought by this army. He was well known to Lee, who, upon learning about the new appointment, warned his staff, "General Meade will commit no blunder in my front, and if I make one, he'll make haste to take advantage of it." Lee's hard-marching troops had now reached Chambersburg, Pennsylvania, followed by a caravan of supply wagons. By June 30th, both armies were within an area of some 50 miles, with neither side really knowing the exact disposition of the other. Finally, advance units of rebel infantry clashed briefly with a Union patrol about 2 miles out of Gettysburg. With this minor encounter, the stage was set for the historic battle that was to last for 3 furious days and leave a toll of 51,000 casualties. On the first day of the battle, the Confederates broke the Union line west of Gettysburg. Federal troops rushed in disorderly retreat down the turnpike into the town, jamming its streets and alleys. 5,000 prisoners fell into rebel hands. It was a great victory for the South, but the battle was far from over. South of Gettysburg, Union forces had rallied on the high ground of Cemetery Hill and Culp's Hill and made of this position the impregnable right flank of a line shaped like a fishhook, extending down to the eye of the Round Tops. On July 2nd, Lee hurled his divisions against this eye. He seized Devil's Den in its woods, secured the ridges on the Emmitsburg Road, but failed to take his primary objective, Little Round Top. It was during the bombardment of the second day's battle that Colonel Fremantle, the British observer who was traveling with Lee, noted that when the cannonade was at its height, a Confederate band of music between the cemetery and ourselves began to play polkas and waltzes, which sounded very curious, accompanied by the hissing and bursting of the shells. Final day of the battle dawned, bright and hot. An unearthly quiet had settled over the battlefield after the Confederates had failed once again to take Culp's Hill. As the sun rose higher in the sky, burning through the early morning haze, it revealed a chilling sight to the Union soldiers. Long lines of Confederate artillerymen were massing cannon opposite their center. Feverishly, Meade ordered his batteries to limber up and to advance to strategic points. Then his men waited. An officer at Meade's headquarters described the eerie noontime lull. We dozed in the heat and lulled upon the ground with half-open eyes. Our horses were hitched to the trees, munching some oats. Suddenly, the stillness was shattered by the roar of two signal guns from the Confederate line. In another minute, reported Colonel Alexander, artillery chief in Lee's army, every gun was at work. The enemy were not slow in coming back at us. From Round Top to Cemetery Hill, it blazed like a volcano. There was a pause between acts with the curtain down, soon to rise upon the great final act and catastrophe of Gettysburg. None on that crest now need be told that the enemy is approaching. Every eye could see his legions, an overwhelming, resistless tide of an ocean of armed men sweeping upon us. Regiment after regiment and brigade after brigade moved from the woods and rapidly took their places in the lines forming the assault. More than half a mile their front extends. More than 1,000 yards the dull gray masses deploy. Man touching man, rank pressing rank, and line supporting line. The red flags wave, their horsemen gallop up and down. The arms of 15,000 men, barrel and bayonet, gleam in the sun. A sloping forest of flashing steel. Right on they move as with one soul, in perfect order, without impediment of ditch or wall or stream, over ridge and slope, through orchard and meadow and cornfield, magnificent, grim, irresistible. All was orderly and still upon our crest, continued Haskell. No noise, no confusion. The click of the locks as each man raised the hammer to feel with his fingers that the cap was on the nipple. The sharp jar as a musket touched a stone upon the wall when thrust in, aiming over it, and the clicking of the iron axles as the guns were rolled up by hand a little further to the front, these were quite all the sounds that could be heard. Now our skirmishers open a spattering fire along the front, and fighting retire upon the main line, the first drops, the heralds of the storm sounding on our windows. Then the thunder of our guns shake and reverberate through the air, and their sounding shells smite the enemy. All our available guns are now active, and from the fire of shells, as the range grows shorter and shorter, They changed to shrapnel, and from shrapnel to canister. But in spite of shells and shrapnel and canister, without wavering or halt, the hardy lions of the enemy continue to move on. So across all that broad open ground they've come with our guns bellowing in their faces until now, 100 yards, no more, divide our ready left from their advancing right. The eager men there are impatient to begin. Let them. As if our bullets were the fire coals that touched off their muskets, the enemy in front halts and his countless leveled barrels blaze back upon us. All along the front, the volleys blaze and roll. As thick the sound as when a summer hailstorm pelts the city roofs. As thick the fire as when the incessant lightning fringes a summer cloud. Boston reporter covering the battle could see expressions of fierce rage in the eyes of the approaching enemy. Men fire into each other's faces not 5 feet apart. There are bayonet thrusts, saber strokes, pistol shots, hand-to-hand contests, oaths, yells, curses, hurrahs, shoutings. Men going down on their hands and knees, spinning round like tops, throwing out their arms, falling. Seconds or centuries, minutes, ages. Confederates watched in horror as Pickett's division seemed to melt away in the blue musketry smoke which covered the hill. Shattered remnants of the attacking force streamed back down the bloody forward slope of Cemetery Ridge. On the crest, General Meade rode among the troops while a band played Hail to the Chief. From every part of our lines, reported a Philadelphia newsman, wild cheers ring out. The rejoicing amongst our men is indescribable. The greatest single battle ever waged on the North American continent is ended.